Does the earth turn? We've discussed the faults of the warfare thesis in the last few weeks, the one proposed by John William Draper and Andrew Dixon White, who have a warfare between science and religion, or between science and theology. It is pretty clear that the early Christian church believed that the earth was round, and that much of the warfare thesis is, in fact, invalid. It is pretty clear that the firmament, if it included the sun, was within an order of magnitude of where we would put it today. The earth was believed to be within about 3% of the modern value in diameter. The moon was measured to within about 10%. It was thought to be slightly smaller than we think it is, but not very much. The sun was put at about 1/10 of its present distance. And interestingly, the ratio of the Earth's diameter to the distance of the stars was effectively 1 to infinity, according to Ptolemy. And a lot of people go, what? I thought that the idea that the stars were at infinite distance was a modern idea. But let me point out to you Ptolemy in the Almagest, in the introduction, and this is now available online, in English no less, so that you don't have to read Greek in order to get there. Point 6 in the introduction, thesis 6, that the earth has the ratio of a point to the heavens. Now, that the earth has sensibly the ratio of a point to its distance from the sphere of the so-called fixed stars gets great support from the fact that in all parts of the earth, the sizes and angular distances of the stars at the same times appear everywhere equal and alike. For the observations of the same stars in the different latitudes are not found to differ in the least. What does this tell you? It says that the idea that you could go up a few miles and you'd reach the firmament is bunk. And it was known to be bunk in the days of Ptolemy. We're talking early Christian centuries. It is reasonable then to ask, what was the controversy all about? Because there clearly was a controversy at one time. Galileo's books in particular were put on the index of forbidden books, which we would not do today. It is true that Galileo was neither tortured nor put in prison. But it is also true that he was rumored to be put in prison, and the best evidence indicates that the Catholic Church hierarchy started that rumor, with the express intent of intimidating others who might be tempted to follow him. In other words, they're going to make an example, but not really. While some of the controversy was about personalities and people wishing to save political face, remember this is in the middle of the Reformation, and the Catholic Church is being hit hard with the idea that it's not really following the scriptures. And so if somebody can show that something is contrary to scripture, why, they are going to be immediately in trouble. And the Catholic Church hardened its stance probably more than it should have. Well, definitely more than it should have. The controversy is not completely explained by these factors. And I think that we need to take into account the stated reasons for the controversy. By all accounts, the question that was raised was, does the earth turn? Or to be precise, does the earth move, because it's not only turning but moving through space around the sun in the Copernican system? And here we get to Ptolemy again, that the earth does not move. It does not in any way move locally. And these are the arguments that were being used, scientific arguments, to say that the earth does not move. By the same arguments as the preceding, which is that the earth is to a point. It can be shown that the Earth can neither move in any one of the aforesaid oblique directions, nor even change at all from its place in the center. Otherwise, the stars would start to get bigger or smaller. For the same things would result as if it had another position than at the center. And so it also seems to me superfluous to look for the causes of the motion to the center when it is once for all clear from the very appearances that the Earth is in the middle of the world and all weights move toward it. Now, here they're using the world or cosmos as, you know, the universe, basically. Interesting. All weights move toward it. So you see the round Earth, everything moves towards the Earth. He had some concept of a universal gravitation, which means that for Ptolemy, if you had waters outside of the sphere, they wouldn't all settle to the bottom because they'd be all attracted to the center, which is where the Earth is. And of course, maybe the Earth is at the center because it's attracted to the center. And the easiest and only way to understand this is to see that once the Earth has been proved spherical, remember, he proved that already, considered as a whole, and in the middle of the universe, as we have said, then the tendencies and movements of heavy bodies, I mean their proper movements, are everywhere and always at right angles to the tangent plane drawn through the falling body's point of contact with the Earth's surface. That is, if horizontal is this way, everything goes vertical. For because of this, it is clear that if they were not stopped by the Earth's surface, they too would go all the way to the center itself. Since the straight line drawn to the center of a sphere is always perpendicular to the plane tangent to the sphere's surface at the intersection of that line. So he's arguing geometrically everything falls down, and down is different places in different parts of the Earth. Which is why, of course, the seas don't just run off the sides. All those who think it paradoxical that so great a weight as the Earth should not waver or move anywhere seem to me to go astray by making their judgment with an eye to their own effects and not to the property of the whole. For it would not still appear so extraordinary to them, I believe, if they stopped to think that the Earth's magnitude compared to the whole body surrounding it, that's the unearth that's out there, is the ratio of a point to it. The Earth is very, very tiny compared to the whole thing. For thus it seems possible that for that which is relatively least to be supported and pressed against from all sides equally at the same angle by that which is absolutely greatest and homogeneous. For there is no above and below in the universe with respect to the Earth, just as none would be conceived of in a sphere. It's all attracted to the center, not down in some absolute sense. And of the compound bodies of in the universe, to the extent of their proper natural motion, the light and subtle ones are scattered in flames to the outside and to the circumference. That would be things like the sun. And they seem to rush in the upward direction relative to each one because we too call up from above our heads to the enveloping surface of the universe. But the heavy and coarse bodies move to the middle and center, and they seem to fall downward because, again, we call down the direction from our feet to the Earth's center. And they properly subside about the middle under everywhere equal and like resistance and impact against each other. Therefore, the solid body of the Earth is reasonably considered as being the largest relative to those moving against it, and as remaining unmoved in any direction by the force of very small weights, as it were absorbing their fall. And if it did have some one common movement, the same as that of the other weights, it would clearly leave them all behind because of its much greater magnitude. Now Ptolemy is losing you. You know, the idea is that if the Earth did move, then the weight would drop, but we on Earth would see it dropping off to one direction. And all and the animals and other weights would be left hanging in the air, and the earth would very quickly fall out of the heavens. Merely to conceive such things makes them appear ridiculous. So you have Ptolemy's perspective on the earth moving as a whole. Now he goes on to say, now some people, although they have nothing to oppose these arguments, agree on something as they think more plausible. And it seems to them there's nothing against their supposing, for example, the heavens immobile and the earth turning on the same axis from west to east very nearly one revolution a day. Why very nearly? Because actually the stars come around to the same position every 23 hours and 56 minutes. The other 4 minutes is to catch up with the sun, which is in the meantime moved in the sky against the fixed stars. So, when, or that they both should move to some extent, but only on the same axis, as we said, and conformably to the overtaking of the one by the other. So some people think that the earth turns. Way back when, Ptolemy knew of this theory, which was, I wouldn't say popular, but certainly present among the Greeks. But it has escaped their notice that indeed, as far as the appearances of the stars are concerned, nothing would perhaps keep things from being in accordance with the simpler conjecture, but that in the light of what happens around us in the air, such a notion would seem altogether absurd. For in order for us to grant them what is unnatural in itself, that the lightest and subtlest bodies either do not move at all, or no differently from those of contrary nature, so the stars are sitting there, they're light, they could move easily because they're very light, and they're not moving, but we are, and we're heavier than the stars. Now, I know some of you don't think we're heavier than the stars, and I happen to agree with you, but you have to look at it from Ptolemy's point of view. While those less light and less subtle bodies in the air are clearly more rapid than all the more terrestrial ones. So here's, you know, stuff that's heavy in the air, doesn't seem to be moving, and the stars are lighter, so it's easier to move them. And to grant that the heaviest and most compact bodies, like the Earth, have their proper swift and regular motion, while again these terrestrial bodies are certainly at times not easily moved by anything else, for us to grant these things, they would have to admit that the Earth's turning is the swiftest of absolutely all the movements about it. It would be 1,000 miles per hour. And now we believe it's a little over 1,000 miles per hour at the equator anyway. Because of its making so great a revolution in a short time. So that all these things that were not at rest on the earth would seem to have a movement contrary to it, and never would a cloud be seen towards the east, nor anything else that was flew or was thrown up into the air. It should throw it up and whoo, it goes. For the earth would always outstrip them in its eastward motion, so that all other bodies would seem to be left behind and move toward the west. That's what he thinks should happen if the earth were turning. For if they should say that the air is also carried around with the earth in the same direction and at the same speed, nonetheless, the bodies contained in it would always seem to be outstripped by the movement of both. That maybe the air would be with the earth, but then if you threw the weight up, it should go off to the other direction. Or if they should be carried around as if one with the air, neither the one nor the other would appear as outstripping or being outstripped by the other. But these bodies would always remain in the same relative position, and there would be no movement or change either in the case of flying bodies or projectiles. And yet we shall clearly see all such things taking place as if their slowness or swiftness did not follow at all from the earth's movement. Now, it's a very interesting experiment by Galileo on this very point. He says you go inside of a ship and the ship is moving, and yet the smoke gradually drifts up to the ceiling without being thrown one way or the other, that you can drop bodies inside and they go straight down as far as the ship is concerned. And so if everything's in relative movement, it should be stationary with appearance to each other. And in fact, Galileo did some experiments to show that indeed this was what happened. One of the things he did was to drop weight off of a mast of a ship and notice that it went straight down, regardless of the fact that the ship was moving. And this was really disconcerting to people who thought that, well, you drop the weight and the mast, the ship should move on and then leave the weight behind. The biggest sticking point appears to be whether the Earth turns. The obvious rejoinder was, but it doesn't feel like it turns. You're trying to tell me that we're moving at the order of 1,000 miles an hour and we can't even feel it? St. Thomas Aquinas had apparently reconciled theology with Aristotelian philosophy, and interestingly enough, that philosophy had noticed the empirical fact that all motion on Earth tends to eventually stop, and it takes some kind of motive power to keep it going. Now you're going, but that's not true. It really keeps going and it takes some motive power to stop, but wait a minute. If you don't count friction, then when a body keeps going, that's unusual and it normally slowly stops, right? Of course it does. Everybody knows that if I take a chair and I shove it, it stops. Right? You're shaking your head no, but I mean think about it from the point of view of somebody who's bought into Aristotelian philosophy. It's an obvious matter, of course, that things stop once you quit pushing them. You have to have something to keep them going, otherwise they will stop. Because the fact of the matter is friction is near universal. And it was more near universal then than it is now. They didn't have the ability to levitate stuff on air cushions or on superconducting magnets or things like that. And so it looked like everything stops if you shove it far enough. And so it made sense for him to say that the natural motion is stopping. It then applied the principle to the Earth. It would take some kind of motive power to keep the Earth going and to keep the objects above the Earth going, for that matter. And if there are objects not attached to the Earth, it would take some kind of motive power to keep them going. Otherwise, they would stop while the Earth kept going and experientially fall behind the Earth. You would drop something and it would go like that. Well, actually, to be precise, it should go like that because that way is west. But it doesn't, so the Earth must not move. Newton's laws were still in the future, let alone general acceptance of them. Foucault's pendulum was also in the future. Gyroscopes were in the future. Observations of the two-dimensional movement of hurricanes were in the future. You will notice that we have one here, and it's curving around that way. If you were to have another one on this hemisphere, you would find it curving the exact opposite way. But they didn't have photos of the Earth that you could see that kind of stuff with. Okay. Galileo staked his arguments on the tides, which, frankly, was not a convincing argument. And I think Galileo may have even sensed that, but certainly his opponents did. And modern physics will say that Galileo's argument was actually flawed. That means that there was no empirical evidence for the proposition that the Earth moves that people knew about. Okay? The major advantage of Copernicus's theory was that it was much simpler than the Ptolemaic theory that it attempted to replace. And as it turned out, more accurate too. The Gregorian calendar, which was reformed from the Julian calendar, actually comes from Copernicus's theory. If you're interested, Gregorian calendar is Pope Gregory. One could even keep most of that advantage of Copernicus's theory by using Tycho Brahe's modification of Ptolemy, which is to say the Earth is still, the Sun goes around the Earth, the Moon goes around the Earth, but the planets outside of the Earth, Venus, Mercury, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn, the ones that were known, go around the Sun, which is going around the Earth. And so now you don't need to have the Earth moving. It is true that Galileo predicted the phases of Venus, but again, Tycho Brahe would predict the phases of Venus as well. It is true that the moons of Jupiter were easily accounted for in a Copernican universe where there are different centers around which things can revolve besides the Earth, and not so easily accounted for in an Aristotelian universe where everything had to have reference to the Earth. But if one were being fair, the evidence, depending on how one looked at it, could be viewed as equivocal. And if you looked at it one way, like Galileo did, why he argued that, you know, we probably do move and we ought to be moving around the Sun. If you looked at it another way, you could say, no, we probably don't move. And that the stars slowly turn, and actually the stars rapidly turn, and the Sun slowly turns in relationship to the stars and so forth. If one looks at the biblical evidence, one finds hints that the Earth was considered to be stationary. One can find texts that are most easily interpreted if one assumes the Earth is stationary. One cannot find, and if anybody has a text that you can think of, feel free to bring it up during the discussion or even now if you want, that are most easily interpreted if one assumes the Earth rotates. One really can't find that. And let me give you a few of those texts. One of them is a familiar beginning of Psalm 19. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. That's our friend the Rakia. Skipping down a little bit here, their line has gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them hath he set a tabernacle for the sun, which is as a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, and rejoiceth as a strong man to run a race. You see any hint there that the earth actually turns and the sun sits there and shines on the different parts of the earth as they turn around? His going forth is from the end of heaven, and his circuit, actually this way, and his circuit unto the end thereof, and there is nothing hid from the heat thereof. Well, this is an interesting phrase. There's nothing hid from the heat thereof. There actually are things that are hid from the heat thereof. So maybe this is poetry and we need to be a little bit careful about taking it too literally. Then there's 2 Chronicles 16:30. Fear before him all the earth. The earth also shall be stable that it be not moved. Psalms 93:1. The Lord reigneth, he is clothed with majesty. The Lord is clothed with strength wherewith he has girded himself. World is also established that it cannot be moved. Say among the heathen, this is 96:10, that the Lord reigneth, the world also shall be established that it shall not be moved. He shall judge the people righteously. And finally, Psalm 104, which is, as many of you may know, a creation psalm. Who laid the foundation of the earth that it should not be removed forever? The earth is still. Well, actually, that's not quite fair. There are a few texts that talk about the earth being moved. Then the earth shook and trembled, the foundations of the heaven moved and shook because he was wroth. Now, maybe that's not clear enough for you. Then the earth shook and trembled, the foundations of the hills moved and were shaken because he was wroth. That's almost the same thing. And this one is, I can't remember. This is Psalm 18:7. This is Psalm 99:1. The Lord reigneth, let the people tremble. He sitteth between the cherubims. Let the earth be moved. The earth is utterly broken down. The earth is clean dissolved. The earth is moved exceedingly. That's Isaiah. The earth is moved at the noise of their fall. At the cry of the noiser was heard in the Red Sea. This is Jeremiah, and again in Jeremiah, at the noise of the taking of Babylon, the earth is moved, and the cry is heard among the nations. So maybe we should take those moved texts out of there. They're not quite as clear as one would like. Now, there's another text in Ecclesiastes. And these last two were used at the trial of Galileo, as far as I can tell. One generation passeth away, and another generation cometh, but the earth abideth forever. The sun also ariseth, and the sun goeth down, and hasteneth to the place where he arose. That doesn't sound like the earth turning, does it? And interestingly enough, the next two verses talk about things that we would agree with pretty much. The wind goeth toward the south and turneth about to the north. It whirleth about continually, and the wind returneth again according to its circuit. So the wind actually, there's air circulation patterns. All the rivers run into the sea, yet the sea is not full. Unto the place from whence the rivers come, thither they return again. Now we have the water cycle. And so we have the sun cycle and the wind cycle and the water cycle. Sounds like a still earth. And then the one that's probably the most interesting to me is Joshua 10. Verse 12, then spake Joshua to the Lord in the day when the Lord delivered up the Amorites before the children of Israel. And he said, in the sight of Israel, God, admire Joshua's guts for this. Sun, stand thou still upon Gibeon, and thou moon in the valley of Ajalon. And the sun stood still, and the moon stayed until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies. And this is, as far as I can tell, the first footnote in the Bible. And it comes at a point where people are saying, that can't have happened. That never happens. And he says, is it not written in the book of Jasher? If you're wondering, the book of Jasher means in Hebrew the book of truth. So he says, honest, it happened. You can look it up. So the sun stood still in the midst of heaven and hasted not to go down about a whole day. Now, if you read that, it sure sounds like the sun was moving and the earth was not turning. And there was no day like that before it or after it that the Lord hearkened unto the voice of a man, for the Lord fought for Israel. And I'm going to push it a little further. You notice that Joshua not only had to command the sun to stand still, but he also had to command the moon to stand still, because the moon was moving at about the same pace. Apparently, this is one of these things where as the sun is going down, you can see the moon kind of coming up. And you see, if he had thought it was just all I need is for the earth to stop rotating, he would have been able to say, earth, stop rotating, and then the moon would have stood still automatically. If I try to get inside of Joshua's mind, I see a model that says that the sun and the moon are going overhead and he wants the sun to stop. It's worse than that. If I try to get a model of the writer of the book of Joshua, he seems to agree with Joshua. Now, there's an interesting little sidelight, but this will give you into the first sentence on Galileo. And again, this is available on the internet. And they give it Latin, and if you can't translate, they give it in English. The sun is the center of the world and entirely immobile insofar as location movement. Now, why is he saying insofar as the location movement? Because that Galileo knew that the sun turned because he could see sunspots. But what he's saying is that it's the center around which everything else is revolving, which is, of course, the Copernican theory. And the comment on that, appraisal, interesting, censura. Apparently, censura was originally not quite as judgmental as we think. All have said the stated proposition to be foolish and absurd in philosophy, semicolon, which was turned into a comma or not anything at all in many things, and formally heretical, since it expressly contradicts the sense of sacred scriptures in many places according to the quality of the words and according to the common exposition and understanding of the Holy Fathers and the learned theologians. And you're going, what are the Holy Fathers and learned theologians? Well, this is a point at which the Catholic Church was asserting that tradition counted for a great deal. And so here's a practical application of that. And it's interesting. All have said it's foolish and absurd in philosophy. It's stupid science. And it's stupid scriptural interpretation. And the second question that came up is, the earth is not the center of the world and not immobile, but is moved along whole itself and also by diurnal, or if you prefer, daily motion. And their assessment, all have said this proposition to receive the same appraisal in philosophy, it's stupid philosophy, and regarding theological truth, at least to be erroneous in faith. Were they now, of course, we would all, I think, agree that it's not quite as stupid in philosophy as the assessors believed it to be. The question I have is, what about theological truth? Again, we're going to look at one of the old resources, and you get a bit of the background as to why this thing was being put the way it was. This is Council of Trent, Session 4, celebrated on the 8th day of April, 1546, under Pope Paul III, decree concerning the edition and use of the sacred books. Moreover, the same Holy Council, considering that not a little advantage will accrue to the Church of God if it be made known of which of all the Latin editions of the sacred books now in circulation is to be regarded as authentic, ordains, and declares that the old Latin Vulgate edition, which is in use for so many hundreds of years, has been approved by the Church, being public lectures, disputations, sermons, and expositions held as authentic, and that no one dare or presume under any pretext whatsoever to reject it. Now, before you laugh too hard, remember that there are people for whom the King James has that same kind of authority. Furthermore, to check unbridled spirits, it decrees that no one relying on his own judgment, like Galileo, shall in matters of faith and morals pertaining to the edification of Christian doctrine, distorting the Holy Scriptures in accordance with his own conceptions, and see, that's not a good idea, right? Presume to interpret them contrary to that sense which the Holy Mother Church, to whom it belongs to judge their true sense and interpretation, has held and holds, or even contrary to the unanimous teaching of the Fathers, even though such interpretation should never at any time be published. So that's what Galileo was looking at. In fact, it goes on to say, those who act contrary to this shall be made known by the ordinaries. I think that means they're to be ratted out. And punished in accordance with the penalties prescribed by the law. That's right. Now the question is, was Galileo above the law? Well, apparently he was. The Catholic Church has had to eat crow over this. And as a result, they have gotten very, very reticent to challenge science, which is perhaps understandable. In the end, though, at least in my opinion, and I think in most of yours, Galileo was right and the church was wrong on the issue of whether the earth moves. Which means that either Scripture or the church's use of it was wrong. You take your pick. Can we, in the light of the Galileo affair, interpret Scriptures with authority? And if so, how? Does this destroy the authority of Scripture? Or if we back off on certain kinds of assumptions that we make, can we make Scripture still authoritative? And this is important because in a book that I wrote, called Scientific Theology, which, believe it or not, was published by La Sierra University Press, I made some points. One of them is authority is the ability of some source to contain knowledge and particularly to prescribe a course of action either without other influences or against other influences. In other words, if you don't know what to do and the authority says to do A, then are you going to do A? If it does, that source has authority for you. But that's if you don't know what to do. Can you come to a point where, you know, ordinarily you'd be inclined to do B, but the authority says to do A, and so you're going to do A instead? That is the question of authority. Now, what that means is that a useful authority has to be falsifiable. A useful authority is one where you can actually use it. That you can say, well, you know, I know that everything else points towards B, but, you know, this authority says to do A, so I'm going to trust it, and I'm going to do A instead. Well, that means that if an authority can do that, ever says something worthwhile, ever says something that will actually tell you what to do, that authority, if could eventually be wrong. And falsifiability and predictive power are the two opposite sides of the same coin, which is why falsifiability was held up at one time by Karl Popper. I don't think it's the entire answer, but it is a very important part of the answer. If your authority never tells you anything, then is it really an authority? In fact, what's really scary is that an authority is most useful precisely where a falsely attributed authority is most dangerous. Normally I'd do B, but the used car salesman tells me that I really ought to do A, so I'm going to believe him and do A. But he's not really an authority, either because he doesn't know, or in this case, more likely because he has an ulterior motive. And you wind up doing A, and you wind up losing tons of money, or maybe your life. Okay? So that's why authority is really scary to deal with. Because if you're wrong, it could hurt. Now, there is what I call the naive view of biblical authority. And the reason I call it that is because very few people who really get into biblical authority hold this view. But it's a simple view, and it's kind of, you know, God says it, and I believe it, and that settles it. God is perfect. Therefore, anything he makes is perfect. Therefore, there are no mistakes of any kind in the Bible because it's God's word. Well, as some of us know who've read, for example, Revelation, there are all kinds of grammatical mistakes in the Bible. Well, we're not talking about grammatical mistakes. We're talking about the ideas. Well, maybe it's really what happened was that it's gotten corrupted, see, and the original documents were fine. And that's a more nuanced view. Of course, every time you do this, you back off a little bit from the kind of authority, because maybe this is not in the original documents, and therefore maybe it doesn't actually belong. Maybe it isn't verbally inspired. There's always the question of mistakes in translation or transcription. I do recall somebody making mention of those once. But every time that we say, well, that's probably the explanation for this particular problem, then we have to worry, well, maybe it's an explanation somewhere else. And we need to be a little more careful about pushing the exact verbiage. Then there's something that's a little more sophisticated. It's called ideational inspiration. What it says is that the words were not dictated, but the thoughts were inspired. And so if you can get the thought out of the text, then you're fine. But the implication of that is that there are no wrong and therefore uninspired thoughts that were expressed by the inspired authors. The fact of the matter is that you'll have a hard time proving that one from Scripture. What about John the Baptist? Jesus implied that John the Baptist's message was from God. I happen to agree with Jesus in that regard. Now, think about it a little bit. A little later on, John the Baptist was confused about whether Jesus was the Messiah. Remember that story? And Jesus said to the, interestingly, he didn't say, John, tell John, just shut up and believe. He said, look at the evidence. People are coming to me, the blind are healed, the lame, the dead are raised, and blessed is he who is not offended by me. And he felt that was a good enough answer. And as far as we know, it was. Even tighter, you can say Peter confessed that Jesus was the Messiah, and Jesus said that this knowledge came straight from God. And I'm quoting Jesus' words. Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And that's actually a pretty good translation from the Greek. But very shortly thereafter, in that same passage, Peter had a wrong conception of the work of the Messiah, for which Jesus had to rebuke him sharply. You remember, Jesus is saying, you know, Son of Man is going to get into trouble. And in fact, they're going to crucify him eventually. And Peter says, no, this can never happen to you. And Jesus turned and said to Peter, get thee behind me, Satan. Thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men. Pretty strong rebuke. So Peter had inspiration, but he did not have inerrancy in words or even in thoughts. Now, I'm going to make the case that the earth turning cannot be predicted by the Bible. Those of you who want to argue otherwise are certainly welcome to. I think at least some Bible writers seem to believe that the sun usually moves and the earth is not moving. That's the common sense view. If we admit that these Bible writers do not have the authority that some have attributed them, we have to be similarly cautious in other areas where the Bible seems to indicate similar ideas, especially ones where it's not. If you were to ask Joshua, didn't you mean for the earth to stop moving? You'd be lucky if you didn't get a butt end of your spear in your side. Because he's not really interested in that. He wants time. And yet, going this way without some stopping point would lead to the weakening and eventual destruction of any authority for the Bible, whatever. So the question is, can we find a stopping point? I think one of the stopping points will be, thus saith the Lord. Much of what is in the Bible is history. It is gotten by the usual way of getting history, observations and reports of other people's observations, which are authorities at that time. I mean, we all believe that. How many of you were at President Obama's inauguration? How many of you believe that President Obama was not really inaugurated? No? No takers? But none of you saw it. We believe because other people have told us that. Right? I think that the rest of the Bible should be respected, but the totality of biblical authority does not stand or fall because of it. Some of the Bible is salvation history. Now, accuracy here is more important. If the main points of the story are inaccurate, the story loses authority. Let me illustrate. You have the story of Esther. And it really isn't terribly important whether there's 120 or 127 or 123 or 130 provinces at the time it was written. Although it's nice if the 127 is the accurate number in the time of Darius. But if you were to be able to show that the person of Esther didn't exist, the whole point of the story would be gone. And make no mistake, that story is a story of salvation history, which is still celebrated by the Jews today in the Feast of Purim. Now, some of the Bible is revelation. And I think there's a much higher standard here because most of the time, the inability to check the accuracy of the claim. Now, sometimes there was. Jeremiah was being hounded by some guy by the name of Hananiah, and he finally had enough, and he said, Hananiah, you know what God's told me to tell you? In 2 years, you're going to be dead. Now, if Hananiah had remained unrepentant and had died, I think you could make the case that whatever else Jeremiah says should be taken with a grain of salt. As it turned out, Jeremiah was right. But if the main point of a vision is wrong, there's no saving the authority of the vision itself. And I would have to say that the person receiving the visions in general loses authority as well. This means that there are some teeth in the claim to biblical authority, and by the same token, that it is falsifiable. And by Popper's earlier definition, that makes it science. The argument that the Bible does not deal with reality, but only with appearances, I think that's Galileo's position, must be taken seriously. But on the other hand, you have to explain the appearances some way as well. If the Bible had opposed the idea that the earth moves on the basis of revelation, I think the Bible would be in much more serious trouble. As it is, what we have are kind of incidental references that I don't think have much weight in this particular question. Now, I have to say, liberals are not blameless in this discussion. Joshua is, after all, salvation history. It is appropriate to point out that Joshua, and probably the writer of Joshua, believed that the sun stopped and the moon stopped rather than the earth rotating. But the purpose of all of this was to give the Israelites more time to destroy their enemies, and experientially they had more time. And if you destroy the whole story, then you destroy salvation history. What happened may not be exactly as described, but something remarkable, one might say miraculous, did occur, and this is not compatible with current scientific orthodoxy. Well, should we just pitch it? Well, if we do that, current scientific orthodoxy would not admit that a person can be raised from the dead. Therefore, current scientific orthodoxy is incompatible with any meaningful Christianity. If Christ is not raised, you are yet in your sins. Those who have died already, they're just dead. It is understandable why conservatives would try to avoid the subject of Joshua's long day. It brings them to deal with the question of inerrancy in an uncomfortable way. But liberals have to confront miracle on a regional, if not global, scale. Remember, it has to cover all of Israel at least. And if it really was the earth stopping rotating, then it covers a global scale. And they are just as uncomfortable with this confrontation as conservatives are with theirs. Perhaps this is why. When liberals and conservatives in an open meeting were agreeing that from both of their perspectives on inspiration, women's ordination was allowed. And once this became clear, and the question is, well, why are we discussing it further? I asked them how they handled Joshua's long day, and neither side was prepared to handle the question, even though it is part of an important and historic controversy. To summarize, the question of whether the earth turns is important historically and theologically for biblical exegesis. The historical results of this question encourage us to be careful about insisting on inerrancy, and especially about insisting that the Bible always gives us direct insight into fundamental reality rather than describing appearances. The recognition of this fact makes it easier to deal with such phenomena as a demon-possessed boy. You may remember the demon-possessed boy. One of the multitude answered and said, "Master, I have brought unto thee my son, which is a dumb spirit, and wheresoever he taketh him, he teareth him, and he foameth and gnasheth with his teeth and pineth away, and I spake to thy disciples that they should cast him out, but they couldn't." You know, I have to say, as a physician, that sounds an awful lot like a seizure. And as it keeps going, the same thing happens. I'm going to leave out the theological stuff, which is actually very important and interesting. But they brought him to him, and when he saw him, straightway the spirit tear him, and he fell on the ground and wallowed foaming, and he asked his father, "How long has this been? Oh, since it's a child." And this often cast him into the fire and into the waters to destroy him, but if thou canst do anything, have compassion on us and help us. And Jesus said to him, "If thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth." And straightway the father says, "Lord, I believe, help thou my unbelief," which is an interesting comment on whether faith has to be 100% to be effective. And Jesus said to him, he rebuked the foul spirit, saying to him, "Thou dumb and deaf spirit, I charge thee, come out of him and enter no more into him." And the spirit cried and rent him sore and came out of him, and he is as one dead. Post-ictal. Insomuch that many said, "He is dead." But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he arose. And apparently, because I suspect that if the guy had gone home and had 20 more seizures that day, that this incident would not have made it into the Bible. I think it was a true miraculous healing. But the question is, what kind of thing did this guy have? Was it a demon possession, or was it a spirit? Are we fair in saying, well, you know, we need to interpret things by appearances, and so therefore, and then, of course, that raises the question, did Jesus interpret things in some ways by appearances as well? But that's a difficult question. I said my piece, and now I'm going to give you a chance to respond.
About the demon possession, I wish I had it with me. There's a statement by Ellen White that said that these were demon possessions and not just illness. At least that's what I think it's somewhere in Desire of Ages. I'd have to look it up.
The question I have is it fair to take the Galileo statement and then expand that to say maybe the kid had demon possession, but it was giving in seizures? Because it sure sounds like seizures.
Oh, well, I guess the devil can do that. But I guess I thought you were saying, you know, it was not devil possession, it was just seizures. It was just, that's what other people have said. It's probably just an epileptic seizure, nothing to do with devil possession. And well, I don't believe that after reading Ellen White.
I think that I would be reticent to say that from the evidence you can say it's nothing to do with the devil possession, because
the Bible, it says it was.
But it was possessed. But what I'm saying is that it followed the seizure route. It really did. It looked like a seizure. But it wouldn't have looked like a seizure back then, because they didn't understand seizures in quite the same way we do. In other words, I guess one of the other questions is, could this kid have been helped with Dilantin or with Keppra or something like that?
Did you ever see a pig with a seizure?
I have not. I haven't seen too many pigs.
Oh, you're talking about that time that they were, the devils went into the pigs and they went into the water.
Yeah. No, don't misunderstand me. I'm not questioning whether there is devil possession or not. I have good faith to believe that, in fact, devil possession does happen. I'm just asking whether it's always everywhere exactly the same as what we think of now. Comment here, and I think we had one there as well. Go ahead.
Yeah. Many questions we could discuss here. I would say, as we look at all these issues here in the broader perspective, I think we all agree that truth ought to make more sense than error, and that our information is very imperfect. You know, we talk about square meals that aren't square. We talk about the sunrise and sunset, which so on. Many things cloud up the picture. But it seems to me that we need to look where the greater weight of evidence lies. And with that, some of these things may not all be answered, but look at the area where you have the greatest weight of evidence, and I'm fairly confident that the biblical model wins out here when you ask that question.
I was just thinking about how it seems as though we're tempted to create categories as though influence of a demon or of the adversary has to be separate and have nothing to do with physiology. And yet, I think we all would agree that all of our physiologies have been, in a way, in a sense, overtaken by our sinful fall, which has spiritual and demonic underpinnings. And I would just wonder, too, if in a situation like that story of Christ healing this boy, we might be well to keep in mind final causes, and I think it's proximal causes. So a proximal cause is some disorder in electrical signaling, but final cause is something quite different.
And it's interesting because Jesus, when he is confronted with the man born blind, is immediately asked the question, well, you know, did this kid cause it, or was it his parents? And Jesus' answer isn't neither, but really it was his grandparents, or it was somebody that hit him on the head when he was 6 months old, or something like that. What he says is neither, but that the glory of God would be revealed through him. And as I understand that, what Jesus is saying is, don't worry about why it's happening. Worry about whether we can do something about it. And at least as far as I'm concerned, what that seems to be saying is, don't concentrate so much on the mechanics of what's going on. Concentrate on whether God can help this thing.
I was just going to say, and Keppra and Dilantin might reduce frequency of seizures, but they're not perfectly wonder drugs without adverse effects. And
that is true. If I had a choice between Jesus and Keppra, I'd probably pick Jesus. And that's in spite of the fact that I prescribe Keppra rather than Jesus, because I don't know how to bring the power of Jesus to everybody that comes to me. If I did, I'd probably be famous, if not wealthy. Yes, here and then here.
We're appreciative that Jesus is the healer, but the devil is also a healer. Ellen White says he can make you sick and then remove the cause of the sickness, making it appear that you have been healed. I wonder if Benny Hinn works in this manner.
Well, that's a possibility. And the other thing is that we also know that the mind has a tremendous amount of influence over how the body acts.
Psychosomatic. And Ellen White wrote a very fine treatise on that, mind, character, and personality. It would help us to understand. But whether it's Jesus healing or the devil fabricating a healing, whether the staff turned into a snake or all of these things.
It looked like a snake.
It looked like a snake, and he ate other snakes, you know. I think we have to keep an open mind in this, and I'm not going to argue with your seizures theory, but hey, it's not necessary to be a seizure. It can be a counterfeit seizure.
It could be. There's another interesting aspect of it as long as we're going there, and that is that scientists know this too. And the reason you can prove that scientists know that is because they insist upon controls. And the controls are not just not treated, they're actually given pills and not told what there's in them. Because if you just give some people pills and you don't give other people pills, the people who are given the pills think, I'm being given something wonderful, and they'll get better regardless. That is, if you were to have three groups, one given pills that are supposed to work, one given pills that are not supposed to work, and one not given pills at all, that it is common knowledge in medicine that the ones that are not given pills won't do as well.
And we should give pills to pancreatic cancer patients.
Well, sometimes you wonder, maybe that's part of what we're doing. If they're given this powerful medicine, they will feel better because they know that somebody cares about them and is working on them.
I grew up in Haiti and had several chances of watching devil possession. And I'm very grateful for that, actually, because when I was faced with a materialistic philosophy, I realized how simplistic that was in view of the reality I'd seen. But some of that behavior that I saw was not what I'd call a seizure. One instance, a lady was just about to be baptized, and she became possessed by this devil, and she started cursing against God, cursing against the Adventist Church and everything else. And incidentally, they took her and put her in the water immediately and baptized her, and she came out, and she was totally free of this possession. An incident that I did not witness, but my mother...
Exorcism by baptism? That's one I haven't seen before, but I guess...
the pastors were there. They wrestled. In fact, my dad was doing the baptizing. And they said, what do we do here? Should we baptize her, or should we not baptize her because she's possessed by a devil? And they said, no, she wants to be baptized. We know she wants to be baptized. We're going to baptize her. And that cleared her right there. This other incident, I did not witness myself. My mother witnessed it. It happened during the night right across from my house. And there was a girl there that had been possessed several times before by a devil. And my mother heard her talking in German.
This lady's never been to Germany.
No. This lady's never been there. No, yeah. I don't think that's seizure.
Well, I guess this is a kind of topic in which inevitably it will be reduced to anecdotes. And since it has been, may I contribute one?
May I suggest the plural of anecdote is data?
Yes, you may suggest that. Note is taken. But, of course, an anecdote has to be in the first person, and this definitely is. When I was a research fellow in renal physiology at Washington University under Neil Bricker, same as Stu Schenkel was later on, this was in the very early days of dialysis, when it had just been introduced into this country, and it was very primitively done, and those, like in a laundry tub, and those aspects are the ones that I remember, but I'll refrain from those because they aren't exactly germane to the point. The point is that a young man in his 30s had been out hunting and with a shotgun, and somehow or another by accident, he shot himself in his thigh from a distance of about 6 inches, rendering the thigh nothing but raw hamburger. It was a massive muscular destruction. And of course, the guy went into acute tubular necrosis and acute renal failure at that point. Now, he had been a deacon in the Southern Baptist Church, and the reputation that he had, and of course, God only knows the heart, but the reputation he had was that he was one of the more sainted, pious individuals in the congregation. And he had come to the hospital accompanied by his wife and so forth, to whom ostensibly he had been very loyal and devoted and in love. Now, when he came in, the BUN and the creatinine were within normal limits, but within a few days, the BUN was over 100, and his personality changed dramatically from being a deacon and the example of piety to a raging maniac. And he took it out very specifically on his wife and accused her of all sorts of horrible things and reduced her to tears. And so my fellow and myself spent all night dialyzing him. And he left the dialysis room in back as a deacon. We had dialyzed off the devil. There must be comments. Acute tubular necrosis, the natural history of that is very fortunate. If the patient can stay alive, and he wouldn't have if it hadn't been for dialysis, then the kidney can recover full function. And he did.
So he
it
went
did.
Back to being a deacon.
He left with a normal BUN. He was no longer necessary to be dialyzed. And he went back to being a very faithful and loving husband. And I guess his wife somehow or another forgave him for all the horrible things he'd said under the influence of uremia, if not the devil. And it was a happy ending, as in the story.
Evidence is a powerful word. Dr. Roth used it this morning. Graham Maxwell used it all the time. Ellen White used the term evidence look for the evidence. And I think of John Polkinghorne, the great physicist who turned pastor, saw the cork for the first time, developed the evidence, and many of us have never seen a cork, and a lot of the scientists, nobody has seen it, but he established the evidence to prove it. And I think of Doubting Thomas, who needed more physical evidence. And I'm always looking for the evidence.
Would you like to say, ask the question?
You can't talk too well.
Oh, okay. Well, the question is being raised, how do we explain verse 26? And that's the verse, refresh my memory, is the exact, because I had it up there. Let's see. Verse, that's Mark 9, right? That you're referring to? Then the spirit cried out, convulsing him greatly, and came out of him, and he became as one dead. So many said, he is dead. Well, what you have, I think, is something crying out. You know, it sounds like it's coming from him. Maybe it's in a different voice than usual, but I don't know that that helps us to decide whether it's a seizure or a devil possession or both. And then he goes down. That's what you see. And at least what I'm suggesting is that what we do is we look at what you can see, and we don't necessarily have to take the underlying theory behind it with quite the same absoluteness as we do what the appearances are. That the kid, in fact, did cry out. The kid, in fact, went down. How you explain that may differ from person to person, and eventually the Lord may show us exactly how that worked. But in the meantime, I don't think that we are stuck with the biblical explanation for it. Now, I'm going to do something that I usually try to avoid if I can, because I know that these things go out on the internet and there are a lot of people who are not Adventists who are looking at this. But one of the interesting things that I saw, and there's a couple of times that this has been mentioned in some of the recorded presentations, is that Don McMahon from Australia has done interesting observation as to what Ellen White's recommendations for health are. And when he gets to physiology, she's better than her contemporaries, but not that much better, and not statistically better. When it comes to the recommendations that she makes, they are in the 90%+ range. In one particular case, they're like 96%, which is actually only 2 out of 50 that are not proven today. Which raises some interesting questions. Number one is she really 100% and we just haven't caught up? The other interesting thing is I looked at the two recommendations. The one I can remember is not eating fruits and vegetables together. And if you read the passage where she's talking about this, she doesn't even say, God said, this is what we should be doing. She just says, this is what we do. And so maybe she'd gotten them from some other source, Jackson or Cole or somebody like that. And it isn't really a thus saith the Lord recommendation. But in any case, it is scary, well, depending on whose side you're on, how accurate her recommendations for what to do are, which seems to correspond kind of to the, you've got to explain the appearances. It looked like this. If you can explain all the appearances, it's not a big deal. I'll be willing to listen to your theory. But on the other hand, the event as described took place more or less as described. And you've got to live with that. And that of course means that eventually you're going to have a conflict between modern scientific philosophy and Christianity, because modern scientific philosophy is not willing to allow the resurrection of a dead person, and Christianity demands it. So that in the end, there can be no final, complete, perfect compromise where everybody's going to be happy. Because at least on that one point, there's going to be a difference. So I don't think I can go the complete liberal route, because if I do, I don't have any stopping point, and eventually I just give up on Christianity. A nice idea, but, you know, no evidence for it. On the other hand, I'm not sure I can go the complete inerrantist route, because I run into things where it sure looks like there are occasional small differences between stories in Christianity. Just for fun, take the denials of Peter. How many were there? Everybody says three, but the details are slightly different. And in fact, I've seen one person who is absolutely committed to inerrancy insist that there were actually three, or actually six. And so that way you can fit everybody's into one complete narrative. Except that the whole point was it's going to be three times. And so I think it's easier to say, well, you know, somebody thought it was a maid, somebody thought it was one of the bystanders. You know, who do we get this from? Well, we got this from Peter. And you know, it was probably he hated to think about it. It was such a mishmash that he couldn't make the story completely straight. But there were a few other people who were watching. And John probably comes as close to anything. He's a separate witness. And he wasn't personally emotionally involved in this. And so it's easier to say, you know, so there's a little discrepancy. And that's not central to the point. I mean, if you, right now, if you have an accident, you will get several different descriptions from several different eyewitnesses. And this came home to me when I was a kid. I wasn't wearing my glasses, so I couldn't see very well. And I was close to as blind as I am now without my glasses. But I remember distinctly looking over there, and the blue car hit the yellow car. Come to find out, no, it was wrong. It was the yellow car that hit the blue car. And I've just learned, you know, you take some things with a grain of salt. Comment here. We still have a mic. And then one more comment back there.
The topic this morning was, does the earth turn or does the world turn? I can't help sharing an observation I got from Setterfield, Barry Setterfield. I think you're familiar with him, and some here are.
Yeah.
I don't even know if I've ever played with a top, but he has an experience from his childhood that he recalls playing with a top, inducing it to spin. You know this story?
No, I don't know the story, but
top spinning very rapidly, and you give it a nudge, and it wobbles, and it wobbles for a bit, and then it regains its sort of stability and continues to spin. However, from that point onward, it periodically goes through an unusual figure of eight movement, and then we'll do it again.
And as it slowly unwinds, it does get bigger and bigger until finally it goes down.
Yeah, perhaps so. But he points out that this story of Joshua and the battle could be explained by the Earth's rotational movement going through some sort of a conservation of momentum movement in order to having reacting to some previous upset in the Earth movement, you know, some time previously. And he points out that that event and the later event, which you'll have to remind me or help me with, the king of Israel who wanted to live longer and the
Hezekiah and the
10 degrees of
yes.
The time frame between those two events is, according to Setterfield, the same time frame between that second event, Hezekiah, and the Christ on the cross event,
That's
where by some accounts the sun goes down in the middle of the day.
Well, the sun is darkened. I don't know whether that means
right.
It goes down or not.
Correct, but depending on how you want to interpret what happened there. But.
Well, the interesting thing about Hezekiah's thing is that it not only happened in Judea, but it happened all the way over in Babylon, which is, several hundred miles over a different way. So that sounds like a global movement rather than a local one. Interestingly enough also, in the time of Ahaz, the sun went down a little faster, apparently, and that's why it's the dial of Ahaz that the sun will go back again. But we have a comment back there.
As long as the topic was on medical aspects, especially intricacies of medical diagnosis, I greatly hesitated making any comment. That's not my field. But thankfully, the comments are moving more into the question of inspiration, which I've spent a lifetime thinking about. And I know there are a lot of variations of views, even within inerrancy. You've mentioned that. There are degrees of inerrancy among inerrantists.
I have a fascinating book at home that's Walter Kaiser's and three other people, and it's called Hard Questions in the Old Testament or something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're entertaining the idea that creation didn't happen in 7 days, which is, you know, to me is fascinating for an inerrantist.
Exactly. And there's a lot of ink spilled on questions like that among our evangelical friends, and I have many evangelical friends, and I attend their meetings now, so that I understand more and more where they're coming from. It's interesting that within Adventism, since you mentioned Ellen White, and we don't often talk in depth about Ellen White, but it's interesting, sometimes our views are of Ellen White's statements really border on inerrancy, don't they?
They do. They do.
They,
and interestingly
they come
enough, she
very close to
call
that.
Herself inerrant.
And she disavowed it, and she actually was borrowing language from Calvin Stowe. He wrote a book on the origin history of the books of the Bible, which she had in her library. We know she had the book.
And was it underlined and stuff?
No, she wasn't great for underlying. I've held in my hands several dozen of the books that she probably used. I visited White Estate just 2 years ago during the summer.
So we can't prove that she read it, but she did at least have it in her
well,
library.
Well, we can with one book, Henry Melville, and a clergyman. And when she wanted to use some of his material, with black ink, she drew dotted lines all the way up and down the side of the page of the exact passages that she wanted to use. You know, there is great respect for the beauty of a book, and you didn't want to desecrate it. Now,
I understand, because none of my books are underlined.
Yeah, a lot of people don't underline at all. So Ellen White was that way. But we have that one book, and then another book in the on the fly leaf, she often signed her name. That's how we know for sure. We can prove for sure that they were Ellen White owned. Ellen White owned. Whether Ellen White read, that could be debatable. But she says, save this volume because there are many gems of truth in here that we must pay attention to.
That's the... the book on inspiration by Stowe?
No, it's another book.
Oh, okay.
I kind of leaped beyond to another topic.
But anyway, so come back to Stowe or?
So, yeah, Stowe, it's very definitely that inspiration is not verbal inspiration, it's the men who are inspired. She's assuming that all the books were written by men. We could debate that. Maybe some were written by women. There were women prophets in the Bible times, so maybe. But as far as we know, so she says the men were inspired, not the...
Well, the one thing to keep in mind is back then, it was, not only was it usually men, but she is quite happy to include men and women. If she says men... She includes everybody.
It's generic.
Because it was traditional
back then. Very much generic. And the women's
They didn't have the sensitivity towards inclusiveness that we have today.
Right. So she uses the clever terminology, it's not the pen that's inspired, it's the pen men. And that's important to Adventism. Often when I talk with my evangelical friends and I get to know them so that they understand where I'm coming from, I can say, look, we have some insights and this is why we don't go exactly the route that you're going. So inspiration is very important, and that's a major issue. I think we have some more thoughts, do we?
A little, yeah, on about move in those... biblical texts. It's not on your subject, but I'm just wondering, it struck me as you were reading those, how is that term being meant? We didn't even talk about the meaning, we just used the word move, and we're maybe assuming it means a certain kind of movement. But I'm wondering if I would have kind of interpreted or understood it to mean it's not being moved out of its place, like it's going wild, or an unusual movement other than the normal flowing of life on Earth. It's not, it's solid on its foundation, the way God put it there, and it's not being moved out of its place. Not that it was referring to it's not spinning on its axis.
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't consider that was the subject at hand myself.
Yeah. Well, I think one thing that we have to be careful of, and it's hard for us because we're looking at the exact opposite problem, but the problem for the church at that time, and it was true for the Catholic Church, it was true for the Protestant churches, because they had the same questions and they came to the same answer, although they didn't, they weren't quite as mean as the Catholic Church was, if I can put it that way, about what they're going to do about it. As interestingly, Kepler and later Newton seemed to have grown up in Protestantism, where the Catholic Church had kind of shut down that area of inquiry. What you have is the science seems to indicate that the Earth is still. And you can see why they would think that. The Bible seems to indicate that the earth is still. Maybe we're pulling too much out of the Bible, and there were people even back then who would concede that, it might be true that we should interpret the Bible a different way, which is fascinating if you're thinking of verbal inspiration and absolute, how can you interpret the Bible a different way? But there were people who were actually raising that, and there were people who were saying, look, Galileo, you don't have enough evidence, so shut up. And it's like, you don't have enough evidence. And so what's happening is that these little hints that I don't think amount to enough, and I think most of us here don't think amount to enough, that suggests that maybe the Earth is stationary and that everything turns around it, including the sun. That we tend to be overly enthusiastic about interpreting that as being for real when it fits our model. And then when it doesn't, we suddenly say, well, you know, maybe it wasn't quite that way. And what it suggests is that in the Bible, we should be careful about majoring in minors. And that what we should really be looking for is the fundamental message that comes out. And of course, the fundamental message is that God is love. In case you're wondering, I am I got my master's in religion under Graham Maxwell. So,
good. This has raised some more points. anyway, I believe in absolutes. You know, my wife, when she got her doctorate, University of Maryland, a class of all doctoral students. One day, the issue was Are there any absolutes? And almost every class member said, there are no absolutes because everything in life is relative. Our understanding of the universe is relative. Even our understanding of God is relative. There are absolutely no absolutes, and therefore in ethics there are no absolutes. And she had to raise her hand and say, I take exception to that. But
well, you know, it's interesting because the question I would raise is, are you absolutely sure of that?
that's kind of a play on words, but anyway. the thing about absolutes, even with Scripture, there are absolutes, at least I believe. But all absolutes have an aspect of relativity when it comes to language explaining absolutes. And sometimes it's a whole series of relative statements, and you build up a progression using logic, using all kinds of things, but eventually it's like a funnel, you're going to narrow it down until you have one option left, and the one option is an absolute.
Well, that's what we have done with the motion of the earth.
Yeah. That there's a parallel here.
That's what we have done with the motion of the earth. And I think that the same kind of procedure, I'm reluctant to take one text. I'm reluctant to take hints in one or two texts. I want to have something that is, one, pretty clear, but two, I'd like to have it connected to, and this is what God wants you to do.
Yeah.
Because if I don't have a connection of that kind, then to me it gets kind of fuzzy. Now, In the matter of creation and 7 days, we have God's the only place in history where we have God speaking it and then writing it down and then writing it down after the first copy gets destroyed. Mm-hmm. Exactly. All over again. And he says, I did it in 6 days. Mm-hmm. And then he goes on to tell the story of how he did it in 6 days. And for those of us who were here looking at the Old Testament, you can see the idea, the general idea, is suffused throughout the Bible. And I think when you have those kinds of consiliences, we haven't dealt with the New Testament, but the New Testament is the same way. Jesus uses the creation story to trump the Mosaic law. Mm-hmm. That just tells you volumes about Jesus' respect for creation.
While I have the mic and while it's being transferred, one more thought about absolutes and what direction we can go with them. I don't want to sound critical of my inerrancy friends, both within Adventism and outside. There are many that they will, even Adventists will deny.
Well, let's face it, inerrancy is the natural position.
Yeah, it's a easy position because you view everything in one through one set of eyeglasses. But keep in mind that if you have to go the full route of inerrancy, then everything becomes inerrant to prove inerrancy. So you have to. It's a whole ball of wax, and you know.
And there's some pretty heavy burdens like the denials of Peter.
So What I'm suggesting, I think the Adventists have a middle of the road, and that's that we can use statements that are not inerrant in the classical term to establish truths that are everlasting, unchanging truths. And I believe Christ did that, Ellen White in her statements, things on health.
And we do that in science.
And we do it in science. That's the point.
I was going to say that it seems the real question is, back to your original statements in your book there about authority. And it seems that, you know, we use the Bible, we use other things in our life as an authority, and it's because we've built up some trust in them, and we've used them for our life or whatever. I mean, we wouldn't be here in this class thinking about any of this if we didn't have some use for this authority that's in the Bible. If it was just, you know, something else, some other entertainment, we wouldn't really be here. But it reminds me that authorities need to be handled in a way that you trust it because you've studied it, you've gained that trust in it. Seems to me like the story that was in the newspapers this week about the gentleman with his Tesla motor vehicle who trusted his autopilot function a little too much. He did not keep his hand on the wheel, and well, that was the end of that. So no matter what, it seems that the authority must be something that you've used, like you said, to predict, well, A or B. Well, I'm going to do A because the authority says A, but why do you trust that? It's because you've built up over time that trust factor, because the last three times you did something, the A actually turned out to be the correct mechanism.
Right.
I also was reminded, I was doing a bunch of really complex calculations for a project I've been working on, and the empirical evidence tells you to do calculations a certain method, gives you displacements for some ground movements, and then there's supposed to be...
But you're eventually going to build a bridge on or something, right?
Well, in this case, there's a school, and I have to know if the school is vulnerable in an earthquake to being destroyed.
Right. So this is practical knowledge.
Absolute practical knowledge. So the problem being that the empirical evidence is for this lateral displacement in an earthquake is very minimal because there's been minimal observations. So how reliable is it? So they're supposed to be by the authority that is, in other cases, another method that's supposed to be more accurate to calculate this stuff. So I went through a whole bunch of complex calculations to calculate this stuff according to what the authorities said should be the case. And I got to the end of it and realized it was all bogus. Had to throw it all out because it was giving me the opposite results of what most obviously should be the case. It was saying that I was getting higher displacements as I went further away from the bank of the river, which obviously can't be the case according to any observations or even, you know, your intuitions of what should be happening. So my point being, even though the authority said I should use this other method, you still have to use your own judgment, and that judgment has to be based upon your knowledge of what the authorities say and the limitations of the authority.
And the idea is that there are sometimes limitations of the authority, and you have to keep those in mind while you're looking at whatever question there is.
Exactly. That's where judgment comes in. So I would say that your judgment, you know, in interpreting the Bible and in applying what you believe God is trying to work in your life and your day-to-day activity, has to come over time as you gain more experience with it, and as you delve into these questions deeper, you understand better what's there, and you can apply your judgment more to the next thing. Because, you know, like you said at the beginning, you know, some people take that kind of naive view where it's just absolute and here it is and I don't need to look at it. well, that I don't think really is a good way to use the authority.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that the very proposition that there are no absolutes is self-stultifying for the following reason. Absolutes demand or require a constraint on the universe of discourse.
Yeah. Well, I think that you're right. I think I'm going to kind of close it at that point. Next week we'll be talking about reproducible evolution, and I think that it should be of interest to some of you. And those of you who have suggestions for topics further are welcome to make them, and we'll see what we can do to bring those to the fore and discuss them. See you next week.